name is Diane August, and I'm a senior research scientist at the Center for Applied Linguistics, which is located in Washington, D.C. Vocabulary is very important because it is key to reading comprehension, and English language learners are notoriously poor in reading comprehension. So if you look at the research literature, you'll find that second language learners do very well on word level skills like decoding and spelling, but they do very poorly on the text level skills like comprehension and writing. So we really need to think hard about how to develop vocabulary in these students, because only in doing this will we improve their reading comprehension. And then, of course, reading comprehension is important because it is instrumental in helping children learn what's presented to them in classrooms, either orally or through reading itself. And one other thing that's really important to think about is that children who don't understand the text that they're reading don't understand the text, but in addition, it's difficult for them to learn new words from the text. So poor vocabulary leads to poor vocabulary because children can't take advantage of the text itself or what they hear to increase their vocabulary. So you need to really give them a good basis in vocabulary to help their oral comprehension, their reading comprehension, and their ability to take advantage of school. I also want to say that there are various things that you need to think about when you're dealing with second language learners. For example, you need to think about what background knowledge they have and what language and literacy skills they have, both in their first and second language. So with regard to background knowledge, for example, it's much easier for children to learn words if they have the concept that that word is related to than if they don't. Because then it's a mean, really all they have to do is learn a new label. So if they have the concept and they have the word in their own language, then learning a second language, you just learn a new label. However, for a lot of children, especially children from poor backgrounds or with poor and interrupted schooling, they may have they may lack the concept for the word also. And so you really have to teach the concept and the label, which is much more difficult. Okay, so I'm going to talk first about teaching individual words. And we really have slightly different strategies depending on the age of the child. So we've been working in a district in South Texas teaching individual words prior to reading children stories. Either we're reading them rich children's literature, narrative texts, or we're actually using science texts that are aligned with the district science curriculum. So what we do is we choose key words from the story to pre-teach. We pre-teach very few of these words because it takes a lot of sitting still for the kids to go through this exercise. But we also see this not just as important in teaching these particular words, but it gives children semantic links, so to say, to other words and concepts. So it's a way really to get kids talking about words, and you build their language proficiency and vocabulary knowledge this way. And we teach three kinds of words. So we teach what we call keywords. So these words are important to the kids in terms of helping them understand the story. They're words that have a lot of depth of word meaning. So they tend not to be concrete, but have nuanced meaning. They're the tier two kind of words that Isabel Beck talks about. So Isabel Beck has done a lot of work examining how to develop vocabulary in children. She has published a book called Bringing Words to Life, which really talks a lot about different methods to develop vocabulary in children of different ages. And a lot of the ideas that we've used in our work really have been borrowed and adapted from Isabel's work. And we teach basic words. So these are words that English language learners are unlikely to know, but monolingual speakers are likely to know. So for example, rooms in a house, kinds of furniture, names of fruits and vegetables, things like that. We try to pick a theme that's tied to the story to figure out which basic words to teach. And we also teach things like other words and phrases. And these are words that are very important for understanding connected texts. So adverbs and adjectives and idioms. So for example, an idiom, near and far. What does that mean? Or even once upon a time. Words like slowly, quickly, nearly. Words that connect different propositions, like thus, so, because, however, but. So we try to teach these words explicitly to children. So I'm going to give you some examples of what we do. We find pictures that we use because we learn that just giving children the, trying to give the kids a definition of the word without a visual is very difficult for them to really know what the word means. So I'll show you the picture, but the first thing we do is we say the word in English. We give a simple definition in English. Then we say the word in Spanish, define the word in Spanish. Then we show a picture that contextualizes the word. And then we explain the word's meaning through the picture. Then we show the children another picture and ask them to do partner talk, where what they do is they talk with each other to try to explain why the picture demonstrates that particular word meaning. So I'll give you an example. So this is the word bold, and after we did what I just told you, we'd say to the children, let's look at a picture that demonstrates the word bold. This person, and we do a lot of pointing here so the kids understand what we're talking about, is bold. He is jumping with a parachute, which means he is not afraid of doing risky things. So then we'd show the children another picture, and we would say, turn to your partner and talk about why this picture demonstrates the word bold. And then they would share that information. So that's an example of how we teach vocabulary. Then we'd have the children repeat the picture. So in terms of some of these basic words I was talking about, this is an example. So here's a picture of tomato slices. And the way we would teach this is say, this is a picture of tomato slices. Tomato slices are pieces of tomato that are cut with a knife. People put tomato slices on sandwiches and salads. When you cut a tomato into slices, it looks like this. And you know, one thing I didn't say is we use a lot of motions with the kids to keep them involved. So we'll say, let's all pretend to cut tomato slices. Remember, we only use a knife when we are with an adult. So this is just an example. But what's interesting here is we're not just doing the word tomato, we're doing the word tomato slices. And here we have a picture of celery stalks or an ear of corn or a head of lettuce or a clove of garlic. So each week with these young children, now we're in second grade, we work with first grade children also. We're teaching about 10 of these keywords, 8 to 10 keywords, and about 10 basic words. I should say also in teaching individual words, you can't teach all the words children don't know when you read a story to them. So we pick other words that are key to the story, and we use the word or in the context of reading. So we'll say the word, we'll use the word or, and we'll give the children an easier word for the word that's a little bit more complicated, as an example. Now, we use slightly different methods with older children. So for example, right now we're working in sixth grade science classrooms trying to teach children very technical vocabulary as well as academic vocabulary that cross-cuts different subject areas. So what we've done here is we've given the kids glossaries to use. And for both the technical words and the academic words, we have the word, we have a definition of the word, both in English and Spanish, and we have a picture for those academic words that really explains the word meaning. So it's similar to this, but it's in the form of a glossary. And the children, as part of their homework, are supposed to generate sentences, new sentences, that use the academic word they've learned. So they're slightly more independent. But again, we're using visuals, we're using two languages, and we are helping children learn a lot of academic and technical vocabulary this way. And the technical words, I should say, in science are really taught in the context of teaching science. It's very hard to learn vocabulary in subject areas such as science unless it's taught in context. But to help the children review the words, we give them a glossary again. And what's special about the glossary is that, for one, we don't use the textbook definition. We go back to the book and try to create an explanation for the word that's a lot easier to understand. And we also provide children with a definition in Spanish, their first language, which will help them with the word meaning. Another important method of teaching vocabulary is through teaching children strategies to learn words. So just some examples from our own work. We had a cognate intervention that we implemented in South Florida with third and fifth graders. And what we really wanted to do is teach children to become aware of cognates. An issue for children is they may actually have the cognate knowledge but not know to use it. If children come from a language background that shares many cognates with English, then they have a great resource to draw on. And so, for example, cognates are words that are written more or less the same in both languages, sound more or less the same in both languages, and have more or less the same meaning in both languages. Examples: magnificent in English, magnifico in Spanish. Cruel in English, cruel in Spanish. So if children have these words in their first language, especially in their reading vocabulary, they can use this knowledge when they read in English. Now, we're still doing research to determine whether children who don't read in their first language and just have the word in their first language, you know, oral repertoire, can draw on this knowledge when reading in a second language, or whether they really need to be literate in their first language to draw on this knowledge when reading in a second language. But cognates account for between half and a third of all words in a language, which is about 10,000 to 15,000 words. So children who actually are literate in their first language have a great resource to draw on when they're reading in a second language. Now, there is a caveat here that for cognates that are technical in nature, it's unlikely that the kids are going to have that cognate knowledge in their first language either, unless they have solid schooling in their first language. So you'll have to teach the children what the word means before you give them the label for that word. We did exercises where we made children aware that there were such things as cognates. And for example, we would pair the children and have them read a passage and ask them to underline all the words that were cognates. We would give the kids a list of words that were cognates in Spanish, and they would need to write the words next to the Spanish cognates in English. So the English counterpart of the Spanish cognate. Then we'd ask the students to circle the letters that were different between the Spanish and the English word to make them aware that sometimes words didn't look exactly alike. There were differences. We did a similar thing with sounds, because sometimes the words don't sound exactly alike, where we would have the English and the Spanish cognate and have the students work in pairs to rate how alike or different the words sounded. And then finally, we'd give the children a passage from their own textbook and ask them to find cognates in Spanish, or in English, sorry, and tell us the word in Spanish. Now, this was in South Florida, so a lot of the children spoke Spanish as a first language. But we do these similar activities in places like I have in Fairfax, Virginia, where one of the ideas is to give children who normally are the ones that are struggling a little more authority in the situation, so that the fluent English speakers really have to go to the native Spanish speakers to get help in doing this particular activity, because they don't know both the Spanish and the English word. So that's just an example. Another example in our vocabulary improvement project. Now, again, the cognate intervention was done with third and fifth graders. The vocabulary improvement project was done with fourth and fifth graders. We taught children to try to infer meaning from context. Now, there are not many words where you can actually infer the meaning from context, but we would read the children a passage that included the keywords for the week. They were supposed to raise their hands when they heard the keyword, and then for those keywords where you could use the context to support the word meaning, we would ask the students to work in pairs and try to tell us what they thought the word meant by the context in which the word appeared. And the next day, what we did in terms of using context to figure out word meaning is we'd give students sentences that where the keywords were the answer to those sentences, but it was the context of the sentence that told children which word fit into the blank. So again, kids were looking at the context, trying to use the context to figure out what word went into that blank. But we're very clear with students that it's very, it's not often that you can really use you can use context to sort of begin to narrow down what a word means. Sometimes the context doesn't tell you anything about a word meaning, and sometimes it tells you, it gives you a pretty good clue. But those are just a couple examples of strategies that we've taught children to use in terms of learning what words mean. When children hear a lot of other language around the word, it gives them a lot of clues as to what that word means. And that's sort of connected to depth of word knowledge, because words have lots of meanings. And this is partly because the same word can mean different things. So for example, the word bug has lots of different meanings in English. And there are lots of words that are like this, that are polysemous words. But in addition, words have nuanced meaning. So the same word can mean slightly different things depending on the context in which it's used. So let me give you an example. Barry McLaughlin has a great example about pianos. And by using the word piano in slightly different contexts, you mean slightly different things about the word piano. So for example, if you were to say, I love to listen to piano music, piano has a different connotation than if you say something like, if I sit on a piano, you know, it might not be good for it. And so in the one instance, you're thinking of pianos and keys and making music, and in the other, you sort of visualize piano and what it looks like and what it's made of. And so only when children hear words in rich context do they come into contact with the words in these different sort of environments, so to speak. And in only this way do they really learn the multiple meanings of words. As I've mentioned, vocabulary is critical in listening comprehension and reading comprehension. So we really need to figure out the best methods for developing vocabulary in second language learners. These children need to comprehend the text they're reading and to understand the language around them to succeed in school.